Can you say a couple words for us?
Yeah, hi, I'm really pleased to be here. This beautiful room, these fine people. I'm looking forward to externalizing the ideas in my brain.
We can't wait.
We're looking good over there, okay?
Yeah,
that's good.
Okay, so what was the first moment in which you discovered nature and the way that you see nature now?
Well, it might even be a little embarrassing to say, but I was a 25-year-old materialist anthropologist working in the Amazon with indigenous people on doing a study of their land rights and human rights situation, and studying how they used the forest. The point was to try to argue against the World Bank and show that these people actually knew how to use their resources. And so right in the middle of this rational material study, these Amazonian Indians, the Shaninka people, told me that if I really wanted to understand how they understood nature, I had to drink this hallucinogenic plant brew called ayahuasca, which they call the television of the forest, which allows one, they said, to learn things. So I did, and I saw all these images during my first experience, and one of the central images was the veins of a human hand flashing back and forth with the veins of a green leaf. Like the and I could see at that moment that what I was being shown was that a human body and a plant and all the life forms on this planet are made of the same stuff, and that it is actually literally true. I'd always thought that we human beings were somehow above plants and animals, and that plants were just material objects. And it was the day following this experience, after all the visions had subsided, I went down to the river and picked up a leaf of a bush and held it up to the sunlight, and I could see that it was exact. It was just like the pattern of my own skin. And so the experience with these rainforest Indians was like an antidote to the anthropocentrism of anthropology. And I realized that I was fully part of nature. It was like a reconciliation after 25 years of existence.
What about nature do we not understand, other than that we're united? What did you discover about nature that we need to know about?
Well, what I started looking into about 5 years ago was the idea proposed by indigenous people that plants and animals have intelligence like us. Now, intelligence has been thought to be one of the qualities that separates humans from all the other species. But animist, indigenous, shamanic peoples have been claiming for thousands of years, in fact, that that is not the case, and that these other species are minded just like we are. In other words, that they can gauge their circumstances and gather in information and then make decisions about it. They can have knowledge. Well, that's not how I was brought up, thinking about blades of grass and carrots and bacteria. You know, the Western point of view until recently has been that other life forms are like automata. It's just mechanisms and instincts, and there's no mind there. There's no one home. That's the point of view. Well, by looking into current scientific research of what actually goes on inside a bee's brain when it is in a circumstance where it has to make decisions, it turns out that animals, even simple cells, even the cells inside our own bodies, make correct decisions when, and it's testable. You can even put an organism like a single-cell slime mold into a maze. And this is a research conducted by some Japanese scientists recently. And, the single cell can compute the shortest path between two food sources placed at the entrance and at the exit of the maze and get it right. So, there's somebody home. Just how it works is still rather mysterious, but all these blades of grass that were walking around, all these trees that were standing next to, they're as smart as us in their own way. And actually, what one finds, if you look into the molecular detail of it, of a tree, for example, for it to actually send its roots down and then deploy its leaves correctly to gather a maximum amount of light, it has to assimilate information and then respond on the whole plant level. And it does this with cell-to-cell communication using molecular and electrical signals, some of which are identical to the ones used by our own neurons. So plants may not have brains, but they act like them. My brain is, the neurons in my brain, so that we can have this conversation, are sending one another very similar signals that what a blade of grass does just to go about its business of being a blade of grass.
And for the camera, just to help people and we'll illustrate this, and can you tell us another example of intelligence in nature? Maybe two, because I know from reading your book you have a few, more than a few, that you'd like to share with us.
There's a parasitic plant called dodder, and it moves around and lives off other plants. It doesn't give off roots or anything. The way it does this is it wraps around plants and then sends feelers into the plants and gauges their nutritional quality. And it's immediately faced with the, should I stay or should I go? And, botanists have discovered that dodder makes correct decisions. And this can be measured by studying just what is the nutritional quality of the plants that it's parasiting, and that its foraging strategies have the same mathematical correctness as those of animal foragers. But dodder does this without a brain. So somehow within this vegetal organism, there's a way of going into the world, extracting information, and then reaching somehow a decision that is then enacted at the level of the whole organism. Well, this is what you and I do on a daily basis, and we happen to have brains inside our skulls where our computations are somewhat accelerated and souped up. I mean, clearly having a brain helps to accelerate decision-making, but you can reach correct decisions without a brain. That's the good news.
And to push on that again, any more elaboration on how natural intelligence and human intelligence, to help people understand that having a brain, the mysterious intelligence.
Then there is the fact that we, with our big brains, still do not very understand very much about our big brains. Just what goes on inside our skulls. While the 3 pounds of gelatinous matter containing all these neurons does its thing is not known. How human intelligence and decision-making functions is a very mysterious thing. The whole question of consciousness, when you open your eyes and see a film-like image, somehow this three-dimensional color image is being generated inside your skull by this mysterious gelatinous matter that's your brain. You know, if you think about it, you take a 3 pound bunch of jello and somehow imagine that in there is a film that seems like it's outside. You know, this is the mystery of consciousness, and it is not known how the jello generates the film. So, and, you know, clearly there are creatures very similar to us, like chimpanzees, and they also have skulls like we do, containing brains like our own, and clearly they also see films like we do. So there's not just human jelly that generates the film. Whether brainless animals, like a single-celled slime mold or a daughter plant, also have films, I don't think anybody knows at this point. Bees, I am convinced, see films. Bees are very good at going into the world, flying over fields, identifying. They go from flower to flower, always the same, not always the same flower, but on a given day, the same flower. So they can see exactly where the different flowers are, go to them, take the pollen, go home. So they're very good at seeing the outside world with a brain that contains less than a million neurons. That's 100,000 times smaller than our own brains. In fact, it's been demonstrated that these creatures that have brains the size of pinheads can actually handle abstract concepts. This was discovered by a scientist 3 or 4 years ago.
So let's talk about intelligence and our relationship to nature. Why do you think, or first of all, do you think that humanity, in the sense of the Western civilization, is living in balance with nature?
Well, no. But there might be a reason for it. Now, this is speculation, but I'm willing to do it because the question is a valid one. It would seem that there's a branch of humanity that got pushed to separate itself in its mind from nature, place itself above nature in its mind, and then rush towards technology and the domination of other species. And I'd say that we Westerners have been charging down this path for, say, about 2,000 years, I'm simplifying, and actually have been remarkably successful at gaining domination over all kinds of, well, life forms, but also matter itself. I mean, you know, chemistry is a spectacular success. So not only can we take matter apart down to atoms, we can actually make new forms of matter, synthetic matter. But this is not without problems. Each advance leads to new problems. So in Switzerland, they gained the domination of chemistry, and then they started producing DDT and insecticides and all kinds of new molecules that are actually poisoning the biosphere. So each advance leads to new problems, and now we have to figure out solutions to the problems that we've created. I think that this is all somehow moving forward. It seems that we're gaining more and more knowledge while generating more and more problems. And I think we're going to have to think ourselves out of the mess we're in. But actually, being out of balance is can be seen in a long-term process as part of moving forward and regaining balance. It's like walking. Laurie Anderson talked about how walking is falling and then catching yourself from falling. And that's how you move forward. So if you look at it in the long term, this separation that Western humans have done from nature was perhaps a necessary and painful separation that we can now catch ourselves from and go somewhere.
So if we're falling forward and regaining balance, or at the moment we're sort of falling forward a little bit or a lot, do we have time to regain balance, in your opinion, given what we where we are with the levels of human demands on our biosphere?
Well, I think that's a really difficult question to answer. It's like saying, you know, what is the weather going to be like in 12 days' time? I mean, no one can really be sure. And my opinion is, is probably not worth very much. I happen to be an optimist. I also think that we have the tools at hand. When I say we, I mean human beings in general. In other words, there's a lot of wisdom in other cultures about how to actually be in balance, how to listen to nature, how to communicate with it, how to live with it. And I think that human beings are pretty smart creatures, very flexible, very resilient, and they can recover from the brink of disaster and survive the direst circumstances. So, I remain optimistic that we can, and I don't think we're on the brink of disaster just yet, though, of course, the world could blow up in an atomic war in a minute's time. But I think that what life shows us is that life deliberately puts risks in there, serpents that can kill you. You have to, if you're going to be a surviving being, you have to be aware of the risks. It's almost as if life deliberately puts problems in there so that we have to pull ourselves up by our bootstraps. And I think that we are the symbolic species, the species that is best at having ideas and dreaming up solutions. And so it's our fate to have to use our consciousnesses and talk to each other, get over our differences, and think our way out of this. And I find that an exciting challenge. And yes, I'm willing to bet that we'll still be here in 1,000 years.
So having lived down with the Peruvian Amazon people and probably many others, for the camera, since you already know all this, but most people don't, what do they have to teach us?
Well, I think the clearest thing is that other species, plants and animals, are sentient and intelligent. And it is possible to listen to them, to learn from them, and actually even to communicate with them. And this may sound a little esoteric, but it would seem that in altered states of consciousness, it is possible to open up channels of communication with ants, jaguars, tobacco plants, and so forth. So it's not just that there's specific information, it's that there's a whole way of knowing which is about communicating with nature and negotiating with it. We depend on the other species because we eat them to live, so we're in a web with these other species, and it's got to be give and take. And give and take is modulated through a conversation. You can't just sort of say nature is dead and use it and use it and use it. You have to be able to communicate with it. And these people know how to do that. Now, obviously, taking the post-industrial world and shamanizing it and having shamans in the post-industrial world continue to negotiate with nature so that we can survive and nature can survive too is going to be a daunting task. But you know, it's a challenge.
When you're talking to plants in regards to medicine, I know I've read in your books about that. Can you share just what plants have to say or what the method of communication is about healing?
Yeah, well, so this is one of the mysteries that you run into as an anthropologist when you work with indigenous Amazonian people. Is that when you ask them how they know about the medicinal properties of plants, they say, well, knowledge about plants comes from the plants themselves. And what happens is that our ayahuasquero, tabaquero shamans take plant mixtures, and then in their visions, they communicate with the essences of different life forms, including plants, and that's where they get the information from. It took me about a decade just to actually be able to stand in front of that statement and take it at face value and try to scratch my head and think about it. What could it mean? After looking into it for 10 further years after that and seeing that actually it was a factual statement, at that point, slipping into indigenous logic, the question that came to my mind was, well, what's in it for the plants? You know, okay, so plants are communicating to people and imparting all this information about healing and about how to live properly and so on. Why are they doing this? you know? So I asked a series of indigenous shamans in 2001 and 2002 this question. I traveled around the Peruvian Amazon and visiting different indigenous societies and speaking with specialists, and would pull out this question, what's in it for the plants? And oddly enough, the answer that these different people gave was the same, and it was, plants have been around a lot longer than we have, and they care for us like grandparents care for grandchildren. They can't say no when we go to them and ask for something, and especially for healing and information that will be good for life. So they like to help us. It's a pleasure for them to serve and to be used as medicines and as sources of information.
Are plants pissed off right now because they're being mined and deforested, or do they care about that?
You know, that's a good question, and I haven't looked into it specifically. I mean, probably some plants are more pissed off than others, and there are differences between plants. The ayahuasca plant, which is probably the plant that is considered highest by indigenous Amazonian people, because it is considered to be the plant that communicates the most. It's considered by them to be like an international diplomat. One shaman told me the spirit of the ayahuasca plant is like an international diplomat that likes to go into situations of conflict and find solutions. So actually, it would seem that the ayahuasca plant has no problem with conflicts and problems, and actually thrives on that.
That's fascinating. I want to, I guess, because I'm interested, and maybe we can use this, but about the DNA communication, mm-hmm. just the fundamentals of how communication works with plants, and then we'll close it out with some bigger questions again. But how, you know, what you've looked into the mechanism of communication, because a lot of people are going to say, like, how can you communicate with a plant, you know? What do you think is the mechanism of that?
Well, the mechanism of how shamans may communicate with plants in states of modified consciousness remains mysterious. I formulated a hypothesis and proposed a possible mechanism, but it's with the caveat that we don't really know what is going on inside our brains in real time right now, just for ordinary consciousness. We know even less what goes on inside our brains when we see images that do not have an objective backdrop. In other words, when we're hallucinating, how does the brain generate or receive these images is fundamentally not known. It seems to me that there, and what I've proposed in the book, The Cosmic Serpent, that what establishes a unity within all forms of life is the DNA molecule. That's just an obvious statement. The DNA inside a plant is the same as the DNA inside your own neurons. The same not only at the level of the nature of the molecule, but actually in terms of long genetic sequences. You know, I mean, half the genes in the banana's genome have equivalents in the human genome. It's a gene is like a paragraph of instructions. And so half the book of the banana instructions is actually the same as the human book. You know, we really are half bananas. But meanwhile, getting back to what might be going on inside the brain of a hallucinating shaman, well, a brain is like an egg. If you break it open to see what's inside, which is how science often proceeds, then you kill it. So it's not ethical to break open the brains of people whilst they're hallucinating to look at what's going on. And DNA is deep inside neurons, and so even if you do get inside the skull, you'd have to break open the neuron and the problem would be the same again. The mechanism that I've proposed is that DNA also functions as a kind of antenna, and it picks up biophotons. These are photons generated by biological organisms, and it emits them. And it would seem that the hallucinogenic molecule contained by ayahuasca works on receptors on the outsides of neurons in a way that influences how the DNA contained in the nucleus of those neurons is organized. It unfolds, and it unfolds the part of our genomes that are repetitive. And so the repetitive parts, known as junk, become a periodic crystal at that point. DNA is an aperiodic crystal, but in its regular repeats, it becomes periodic. And periodic crystals are used for the transmission of electromagnetic waves. And photons are electromagnetic waves. And actually, the wavelength of these biophotons correspond exactly to the wavelengths of visible light, and in particular to the colors that one sees in ayahuasca hallucinations. But that's just a hypothesis, and more research is needed.
Thank you for sharing that with us. I know it's a hypothesis, but I think it's really interesting. So, as you're working with people and you understand them, how do you see, have you thought of anything about change and evolution at all? How will we shamanize, you know, our post-industrial world, or how do you think we're going to, how does change get incorporated in our culture? Is it going to be through a dramatic loss like Katrina and then we change, or do you think we're going to be able to take in our intelligence and make proactive steps?
Well, I think that the Amazon is interesting for several reasons, one of which is that 20 years ago, at the beginning of the 1980s, the rainforest was called jungle. Indians were defined by development experts as Stone Age obstacles to progress. Going in there and cutting everything down and then putting cow pastures was called development. Deforestation was called development. So, and in the last 20 years, there have been enormous advances in understanding the rainforest, its indigenous inhabitants, the pertinence of their knowledge to the protection of biodiversity, indeed the importance of biodiversity and of sustainable development. The change has been extremely fast and across the board. And if you look...
That sound, but it's fine.
So change.
Are we on speed?
We're back.
Yeah.
We're back? Okay.
Well, I'll just give you that thing about the Amazon.
Yeah, the change and all that. The Amazon is a jungle and all that.
There have been huge and positive changes in the last 20 years in the Western understanding of the Amazonian rainforest and its indigenous inhabitants. In the early 1980s, we used to say jungle. Development experts used to say that indigenous people in the Amazon were Stone Age obstacles to progress. They used to say that the way to do development was to cut all the trees down and to put cattle pastures on top. And so deforestation was called development. It was a strange world, the 1980s. But suddenly, there was very rapid change. And the world woke up, but there was no disaster that prompted it. It just became a currency among development experts, ecological activists. Suddenly, everybody realized, the Indians, it's not about the Stone Age and the past, it's about the future. It's about biodiversity and sustainable development. And the rainforests are important for the balance of the planet. And we're all in this together. This was the late 80s, early 90s, and the big get-together in Rio in 1992 kind of crystallized it. And all these governments started signing biodiversity treaties and sustainable development treaties, and essentially governments of the world were saying what indigenous organizations had been saying 10 years previously. I mean, I don't know of such rapid historical change. So if you look at that trajectory, and meanwhile, indigenous organizations in the Amazon have gone from strength to strength. Their main problem has been their successes. All the money pouring in, and it's led to corruption, and things aren't simple. But if you compare the situation of indigenous Amazonian people now to what it was 20 years ago, 20 years ago they seemed like they were about to disappear. They had to rise up and fight. It was their last stand, in fact. And now their populations are coming back. Families have six or seven kids. They're getting strong again. So if that is a gauge of how things are going, in fact, there's been an exponential improvement. And the dialogue between scientists and indigenous people, but people concerned with the environment, and there's all kinds of communication going on that didn't exist a quarter of a century ago. So let's keep it up.
You want to say about 11th hour, you had a comment?
Yeah. Well, I think it's important to look at human beings in their natural context and also in the context of development. Let me do that again. I think it's important to look at human beings in the natural context and in the context of evolution. And it would seem that life on Earth has existed for 4 billion years, and there have been animals for maybe 600 million years. And mammals for maybe 60 million years. And here we are as primates. There have been primates for 10 million years. Homo are kind of bipedal folks for maybe 2 million years. But the first humans, Homo, using tools, had brains one-third the size of our own. And our brains, in the last 3.5 million years, have tripled in volume. This is the fastest and biggest development of an organ in known biology. And that's been over only 200,000 biological generations, 3.5 million years. Meanwhile, we, Homo sapiens sapiens, the flat forehead, pointed chin, 1,400 cubic centimeters under the bonnet here, have only been around for 200,000 years at most, according to the fossil record and to analyses of DNA. That's barely 10,000 biological generations, which for a species is next to nothing. I mean, if you put fruit flies in a lab and let them reproduce, it only takes 15 years, you know, a fruit fly a day, and that's what it takes for 10,000 biological generations. It's really next to nothing. So we're a young species, and actually this flat forehead business, it's unlike Neanderthals, who have these sunken foreheads. Our frontal lobes pushed out. The frontal lobes here, which is where all the fancy calculation and planning and foresight goes on, according to brain imagery. This is what occurred in us. And we've only been experiencing this kind of braininess for 10,000 biological generations. We're like in kindergarten, and so we have these amazing brains that allow us to come up with all kinds of schemes, and now we're the world's dominant predators. You know, we've replaced the dinosaurs, and we have this power over all these other species, but we've only had 10,000 biological generations to work on getting a handle on it. And actually, this explosion of human power has only really occurred in the last 50,000 years. And been industrialized for the last 300 years. So we're a really, really young species. In comparison, octopuses, for example, who are really efficient predators too in their own necks of the wood, in the octopus's garden, they've been around 350 million years. So they've had a lot of time to hone their skills and to work out their arrangements. So I think it's also, we're just getting started, and we're bumbling around, and we're like young kids, you know, we break things, and we're not too good, and we don't know our own limits. Maybe we're in our adolescence now, and we're just starting to realize that, we've got to get our acts together and get serious and, you know, get a job and so on. And actually, I think one of the things that is spectacular is that humanity has only become aware of itself as the human race. In the last couple of hundred years. Actually, that European expansion that was so painful over the last 500 years made it so that humanity became aware of itself. There are black people here, and Indians over here, and white Europeans here, but we're all the same. And actually, the similarities between Japanese people and Eskimos and Australians and so on, that we all have the same kind of blood. And despite our different skin colors, actually, we're very nearly identical genetically, precisely because we are such a young species. We haven't had time to have all that much genetic variation. It seems there's less genetic variation in the whole human race than in a band of chimpanzees in Africa, simply because chimpanzees have been around 10 million years and they've been able to accumulate these differences. So we're in the first hour. But I think the concept of the 11th hour is still okay, because we've gotten so powerful, we could blow ourselves up tomorrow morning. You know, that is true.
Okay, so we're doing a message in a bottle to future generations.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say, you know, that we get to put this on a DVD and the DVD still works 100 years.
Mm-hmm.
Or they still have one around. What would you say to them?
Well, I really don't know about that, actually. I haven't ever thought about that.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you don't have to do it if you don't. Or if you want to take a minute.
To think a little bit about those guys.
Or even 50 years.
50 years.
From today.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, actually, I wouldn't really have anything to say to people in the future. I mean, you know, it would be that they should be watching this would be proof that we more or less did a bunch of right things. So, you know, hooray for us, and you know, keep on keeping on. You know, they don't need me to. They're a smart bunch of people if they're watching this, and they don't need me to any kind of advice or anything, so, you know.
Thank you.